is about semantic annotation. So looking really at how to make genome annotation fair, but also more useful. So you often, when you are looking at your metagenomic data set or your salmon fish or your bacterial genome, you have often have questions, which extra enzymes are common among a set of organisms? Or what genes distinguish a certain species or that have a desired trait? These are relatively simple questions, but are very difficult to answer. And the main reason because of that is that you need a collection of annotated genomes. Okay, you can now download hundreds of thousands of genomes from all over the world. But they need to be consistently annotated. So here you have a small overview of the Pseudomonas sequences from 2 years ago. These are the complete genomes, and then we sort of ordered them by the end when they were published. So these are one in 2010, give or take. And we just did a gene prediction again. And then immediately we see that there are many new genes found in the same genome. So it's very crucial that you should do the analysis again with the new current algorithms. And sometimes you find 600 genes less, but that was everything that has a start code on is a gene. That's not entirely true. So it's very important that also it's data mining enabled, so that you immediately can mine all this information and that essentially all the provenance is stored. So talking about fair data, so what is the probability that this gene is truly a gene? What is the functional annotation of it? What tool did I use? What version was it? What was the arguments that I used? And who did it actually? So all this information should be stored. So the current formats, some of you might know them. So here you have the GenBank EMBL format, the GFF format, and a way of accessing them in the 80s using a floppy disk, which was very intuitive back then, but it hasn't changed much. So we're still not using a floppy disk, but we're still using these formats where you cannot store computational annotation metadata. You cannot mine it so easily or ask any questions. So there is no real resource to achieve this. So if you would like to mine those genomes, you require a dynamic and scalable framework. Because one day you might look at one eukaryotic genome, the next day you might look at 50,000 bacteria or 100 microbial communities. So it needs to be very flexible and scalable. It needs to store everything that you can get your hands on. So if you run a gene prediction tool, all the information that's given by the tool should be able to be stored in this repository. Of course, there are many external resources like UniProts with a combination with SwissProt, Tremble, the reaction databases, and you would like to be interconnected with them because they might get an update and you would like to just stay up to date. But it should also be easy, or relatively easy. So the requirements for fair genome annotation is a platform that incorporates common tools that everybody uses nowadays because some people have time to spend 4 years to work on an algorithm. Yeah, use that information and use that knowledge. We also need a proper definition for what is a gene. So what was this morning is the question about what defines a gene. Does this gene always have an mRNA? How do we define protein functions? And so to do that, we have developed the Gbo ontology, and it's in the bioarchive, and we are looking for collaborators to make this a community-wide standard on how do we now annotate genomes in a semantic way. And the nice thing about this combination is that it's enforced through additional tools that you, when you create a protein in your database and you save it, but you forgot the sequence, the program will say, hey, this is not correct, you're forgetting stuff. So it's very important that these things are taken care of. So in combination with that ontology framework, we've developed SAP, which is a semantic annotation platform with provenance. It is very modular. The common tools are wrapped in packages and then provide evidence tracking for annotation. So you have a genome assembly, you can do a variety of gene predictions, you can have exons, introns, with a certain probability that is correct. You can then have protein sequence, which you can have further annotated, for example, InPoScan, which says this domain has this probability and that domain has that probability. And then you can really dive into, which I will show you some results on that. It's available in BMC Bioinformatics, and this is basically the structure of the database. It might look a bit overwhelming, but we have here a whole range of defining positions. So this gene starts here, ends there, or starts roughly here, or in this range. Element-wise information about sequences and features, sample information, is this a microbial sample, where did I isolate it from? The provenance, of course, what tool did I use, what were the evidence values of that, what is the procedure? Is it manually curated or was this computationally predicted? And if there are articles attached, that will be immediately integrated. So you can link to articles for additional evidence. So for example, if you had looked yesterday at the talks, you might be now interested in metallo-beta-lactamase protein folds and see all these different networks. So what we quickly did was we have 80,000 bacterial genomes and we just asked a very simple question. Give me all beta-lactamase folds, these domain, and what is the probability that it is correct? And they were all very significant, from E minus 5 to E minus 300. And you immediately see there's a variability in the scores. So this could indicate that each peak represents a slightly different variation on the team. And this is basically a very relatively simple question you can ask. And within an hour, you have these answers. You can also reveal then functional evolution. So here is a whole set of bacteria which we then have connected to an external database for anaerobic information, aerobes, for Pseudomonas putida. We looked at diversity in the species. So this quickly gives you insights on what are the information that's stored within. Of course, we also apply it on the eukaryotes. So we have currently the digital salmon genome. And then we use a variety of tools to annotate it further and to interconnect with external resources so we can have a higher quality with all information about the genome. And using these technologies, we automatically connect to what is already known, but also with new information. And of course, there is a poster if you are interested and you missed it yesterday. So it's currently available. It's there's a website, sub.gitlab.io, but there's also articles attached. The Gbo ontology is at gbo.live. There's also the namespace for the ontology where you can browse through. And MPUSA, that is basically the code generator to make sure you're doing everything correctly. So this, of course, is not done overnight. So we had a lot of help from collaborators within the group and with the Norwegian University of Life Science, of which John Olaf, Fabian, and Arne are part of, in the Digital Salmon Project, and of course, in many other projects, and Paul Putra, Infect, and MicroSynVac. I think I'm just on time. Okay.
Wow. Give 8 minutes to a Dutch person, and you can explain everything. So there must be questions for this, I'm sure. Or comments. Yes, please. No, Anna, you are not the first, actually. There's somebody before you. Yep.
Oh, it's all right. I don't want to use it, I guess. My name is Rami from NGN in Norway. Thank you for your presentation. Well, we use mainly Rust, and it's heavily used. So I was wondering, are you only relying on people picking up on this great tool, or do you have some ideas on implementing it so that it's a wide use?
Well, we are currently already having a Galaxy interface so that people can relatively easy use it. We try to make extensive documentation so that people know how to ask questions to the database. And if you want to publish the genome, yeah, you're still rely on the old formats. So we will, of course, make compatibility with that. So there are many ways that you can work on this and it's easily to implement.
Hi. So I've been before collaborating with people in the ESBO community, and they find difficult to find users that support the standard. Because the issue there is like this is made to make things flexible, easier. But how much do you actually need to learn in order to, you know? So I think this is a bit of a barrier. So.
Well, the tools are, it's command line where you can just type it in or use Galaxy to click and start running. The only thing that you might need to learn is how to ask a question to the database. But nowadays, also Uniprot is switching, Wikidata is switching to these technologies. So in the end, you will need to learn this language. And you can connect it directly to R and make the plots that I just showed. That I did it just after the talk. I thought this might be interesting for the slide. You fire a query, you get your results, you use R, and you plot it. So it's very easy to adapt to.
So there is time for one more question and comment. And I just warn you, if nobody asks that question, I will ask one, and it's going to be a philosophical one. So choose. I will go for the philosophical one. So I was thinking this during your presentation and also during Carol's presentation, and you can answer for both of you. I guess in the future we will have made scientific progress so that we would like to want metadata that we currently don't think about, right? Because we will increase theoretical knowledge so that we will see the data with a new lens, in a way, in 20 years. So I think this was alluded to when you said that data also has a life cycle. How do you think these systems will be able to deal with that kind of, let's say, that data quality is also a matter of a moving target?
Well, in that sense, the nice thing about this system we already encountered a few times is implementing new versions relatively easy. And you can compare. So what I did with the first example of those Pseudomonas genome, okay, this is the original annotation from 2010. We do everything again, but we keep everything. And then maybe in 5 years from now, we redo it with new evidence. And then you can compare, does it improve much or did nothing change?
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, please.
That Cameron and I are a part of a movement that is kind of indicating that the old style of publishing, which is publish and forget, is going. And it's now much more a release model, much more like we do software with versioning, with differences, with readmes, with so on. So we should be moving to data releasing, not data publishing. And that means we have to encapsulate all of the things that Jasper was talking about, which is what are the changes, what has evolved, and what additional features that we have. We have to be able to support that.
Would you like an extra comment to that? Or?
No, yeah, it's maybe another thing what I wanted to discuss. So like, I've showed this example of 80,000 genomes. And if you would like to publish that, so make this available, I cannot cite 80,000 articles. Well, I can, but I'm not sure the journal will like it. So how do you then cope with this appreciation to the community? That because I mean, this is all computational work. So I relied on all the other people that sequenced these genomes.
Right.
So how do you cope with that? That's, I think, is something we really need to look into.
Yeah.